side am I on? What side am I supposed to be on? I never know.
Boom, boom, boom. Do that. Damn. Technical difficulties already. What's up tonight? How's everybody doing, man? What's going on? Tim's here. I haven't seen Tim forever. We've got Ancient Exploring Arizona, Mr. Eric. We got Tom. We've got AH was in early. He's always been early. We got the crew going on. How's everybody doing tonight? Good to have Tim back. Glad you're maybe you're off this week because of the holiday. This is our annual Thanksgiving show, even though it's not anything to do with Thanksgiving. It's our annual Thanksgiving show. And what does that have to do with anything? Nothing. It has nothing to do with nothing other than the fact that hopefully it's a short week. Hump day was today. AH is here. And I appreciate that, Eric. Thank you very much for that. Boom. Much appreciated. Thank you. And yeah, let's get the party started. You know, what got me motivated about, and so we'll just jump right into it. Well, you know, one thing I will do is we'll back up a little bit. We don't have, I'll give everybody a few minutes to get in here before we talk about who dat be in history. And you know, what got me going was, there was one of the Facebook pages had something about, you know, it was like they knew what Petroglyphs meant. And I was like, you know, that's an interesting thought process to go there and say, you know what? Yeah, it's pretty interesting to say, wow, we know what these mean. And what do we know about any archaeology today when you really look at it? So that's what we're going to delve into today. We're going to look into that. Thank you, Mr. C. Much appreciated, my brother. Thank you very much. I will tell you this also. Sticker Mule has $14 t-shirts. You can't beat that. $14 t-shirts, black. That's a hell of a good buy. So if you would like a t-shirt for $14, if you want one of my logos, let me know. I'll try to get you the artwork. If you just want to make one for yourself, you still can't beat it for $14. That's pretty incredible. I think shipping is included, but I think you have to pay tax. So where the hell can you get a $14 t-shirt with whatever you wanted on it? Anything. You can create your own. You can take one of mine. You can figure out one for yourself or your company or even some of that loved one at Christmas. You can't beat that. I don't know how big they go, Eric, to be real honest with you, but you know, I got you covered. If you need a t-shirt, I've got t-shirts. I do. I've got a Speed is King t-shirt, a racer out of Indianapolis wanted, and I sent him one extra large. And when I was in there, I found a 3X. I don't know if that's too big for you, but I do have a 3X in that t-shirt. And if you would like that, I will make sure that you get that. And it is your size, and you know that. I got tall. I got everything. I've got it all. So I'll get you one if you'd like, but, you can't beat that though for the average guy, $14 for a t-shirt, any design you want, make it whatever you want. You can go F-bomb, you can do anything. That's what's cool about it. And, so that's one of the reasons I do Sticker Mule for the shirts. Like I get, right. I create one-off shirts that, nobody's got, and I find them amusing and wear them. But that's just me. Tummy shirts are all the rage these days. So that's what we got going on with that. So Sticker Mule is, they have a special. They're normally $20. And so if you'd like to get one, I would definitely, I'd trade for green markers. Absolutely. All day long. I love my green markers. To show you about my green markers, they're on my desk. They never leave my desk other than the fact that look here, there it is. And look right here. Green notes. All the videos that I do actually write out what I'm going to say on the videos that I do for other for YouTube and for other places. And I carry these green markers with me absolutely everywhere. So that's the story on that. So I had one comment down here on Digging Arizona said, I think petroglyphs were like road signs for those traveling and trading. You know, when I saw that site, it was like, I know a lot of people want to think they know. I mean, I know that's something that a lot of people want to go, yeah, I know what that is. I know what that is. I understand what that is. And what I found out is that the more I've looked, the less I know. And so could you make an analogy? Well, could you make an analogy over any of the stuff that the archaeologists are digging? I mean, when an archaeologist goes to a site and he finds something, right? Let's say he finds sherds. Well, did they come from there? Do they know exactly where they were dug? Do they know where the clay was dug from? Do they know where they came from? And sometimes that could maybe be an estimated yes, and sometimes that could be an estimated no. But because something's found at a location, you know, it doesn't mean exactly that where it came from and why it came from. There's a lot of estimation that goes into all this work. And probably I'm going to say that 90% of all the archaeology that I've seen today is somewhat of a best guess. You know, a best guess. And people that spend their lives doing this are probably going to tell me they don't believe that, but that's what I believe. Of all the books that I've read, all the things that I've seen, you're still estimating what it is. You dig a body up, you see that there's a spear through his head. Yeah, somebody was killed, but how and why? Doesn't mean there was a battle of a massive war. Maybe it was a disagreement over gambling. Who knows? But you see 50 people with axes through their heads, you probably got a pretty good opportunity or thought process that something occurred there that was a little more than just a skirmish or a scuffle. But as we go through all that stuff, that is why it is critical that we leave stuff where we find it. And so one day when they come back and try to piece this thing together, they get an opportunity to be able to do that. So they have all the pieces of the puzzle there. But a lot of it's still going to be estimation. You know, Don Barry talked earlier about, you know, any petroglyph that is not connected with the tribes would probably not be accurate. And I would go as far as to say, you know, just in your own life, for example, out there, who has traced their roots of their family genealogy-wise? I know Lines has, but I don't see him on here. But I would like to know how far that you went back when you traced your family roots. How far could you go back and do the same thing with the ancients? Okay. So you take a tribe of today, you take them and you put them in the 1800s. How many people can go back 300 years or 350 years? Very few, even today with the technology that we have, can go back that far. Some can, but what happens is you run out of places to be able to say, find, data that was going to prove that you did that. And so they can go 350, but how are you going to tell what a petroglyph was when it was 800, 900, 1,000 years old? How are you going to tell that? There's no connection between the tribe and 800 years. You know, most of the tribes today are losing their culture and they're losing their language today in 2023. And if you're losing that today, you know, and anybody has ever told that story at a party where you go around the room and you tell a story, and by the time it gets back to the 10th person, the story that you told in the first person completely changes. And that's every history. And so I would challenge any of them to be able to even say, you know, you'll see these things that says, oh, that was an atlatl. Well, this one says it's a butterfly. Well, what is it? I mean, who knows what it is? I believe that religion the same way. Well, you know, there's a lot of best guesses anytime that there's a person involved in any of these scenarios, right? That's going to skew the information. And so you go back and think about this as we go forward. So we're going to do two things right here tonight. We're going to talk about going forward and what it means as far as taking the information we have from the tribe today and going backwards and how far could you get to try to figure out what that says or what that means. And then we're going to go from the beginning, let's say 1,000 years, let's say 12,000 years. And then how far did it go back? And then where did it evolve to? Now, we definitely know there was evolution to this process. We also, you know, we have been able to date the couples, which is the first original petroglyph, which is not a petroglyph. It's a hole in a rock. You know, that's all it is. But that's the original design. So we know that their designs evolved from pecking a hole in a rock to actually creating a design. And then the other side of the coin is you can't call it rock art. I mean, what's art? You know, is it rock art? Well, if it had a purpose or a meaning, I don't see it being art. Now, the problem also gets into the fact that we as a culture decide to name things, and we decide that we are going to put a stamp. You think about the archaeologists that named all this stuff just because that's what they wanted to do. Well, I'm going to name this. I'm going to name this group of people. Well, Hohokam. Well, Hohokam. Hohokam. Well, however everyone want to say it, but what the hell does it really mean? Is it something that came from the ancient culture, or is it something that we as archaeologists, I say we, and I'm not one, but have just named, you know, and then the changes in the different cultures, and well, this is going to be this group and that group and this group. And how in the hell do they know? You know, how do they know? And my challenge is that, you know, it's all a roll of the dice. And so, but we can look at it. We can look at these different designs. And there's some fascinating stuff about petroglyphs. And one of the things that I think is fascinating about petroglyphs is the same petroglyphs are around the world. So there's a grouping of petroglyphs that you can see anywhere in the world, and they are basically the same. Now, that doesn't mean that we got abducted by an alien, but it does say that there was a certain wavelength of the brain in the world at one time. So there was a commonality between people that we can look at. We can look at things like that. We can look at that we evolved from a couple, which is a hole in the rock. Sometimes they would eat the rocks to and that would be the ceremony side of it, supposedly. But then you have to go, well, how do we know that? Well, we don't, unless we go back to the Native Americans today and try to go backwards. But those people aren't the same people directly anyway. There might be some connections, but these people moved and grooved and went all around. They interconnected, they intermarried, you know? So to say there was one group, it was more prevalent when you talked about the Apaches and the Navajo that grouped together and somehow somewhat stayed in their group, but not completely. So there's a lot of this evolution of life in the ancient side that really makes no sense. As far as, you know, you can go to Chaco Canyon and you can decide and see and feel, but what do you know? Well, if you don't dig it up and find something, you don't know any of it. You know, we can look at it and say there were macaw birds, there was Chaco, there was people eating people, there were certain things, but how does that interconnect? And where do these people come from? And the only way you could really do that is through DNA. So you go to every site and you collect DNA when you possibly can. And then what? Well, then you would see what the culture was of the people that were there. But we don't seem to do that on a regular basis because we really don't go dig stuff up like I wish we would. But that's, oh, Steve Lines is here. Bro, is that the Tim Hoffman? It is. Lines slid in under the wire. He forgot to see his name in lights. He didn't see his name in lights tonight, but it was there. You just have to trust me. And so when we look at all these things, we already know that when you don't have a written history, then it's pretty damn hard to realize, Steve Lines, how far has your family went back in genealogy? How far have you got back years-wise? Because I'm just curious to how far people get back because, you know, what was my culture? Well, we lived in France, but we were German. I don't know how that worked out or how that worked out. But past that, we don't go back much farther than the 1800s. So what happened to us? God only knows we were in prison and things like that. There's no doubt in my mind about that, but we don't know which prisons. But here we are. We go back into that. Now, let's say you go back 300 years. You got another 500 and 700 years. You don't have a clue what was going on. And I got an app for that. So my point is that how are we going to judge from what the Native Americans today in 2023 know about 1,000-year-old petroglyphs? You know, they're maybe some lineage that kind of floated through, but I think the truth of the matter is because we don't know who is who. You know, you can say that I'm such and such. I can say that I'm German. I can say that all day long. And until I do a DNA search, then guess what? I'm not. And what I might find out is what happens then when you find out you're not even German. Well, it doesn't matter to me because I don't have a lock on the homeland. I don't really care. But it does matter when you're looking at these different groups that are going to analyze these petroglyphs as being what? Well, they're rock art. Well, it can't be rock art to me because rock art has no value as far as it meaning anything other than, well, I'm doing it because aesthetically it makes my rocks look better. That could be taken a lot of different ways too, right there. So is it rock art? Well, it's not rock art to me. It's beautiful. I love the designs, but it's not rock art. Because if it's rock art to me, I look at it as being, it doesn't have a purpose other than to beautify. I got a couple of lines to the mid-1500s. That's pretty far back, Michael Hardy. So 1500s, but still, even as far back as that is, and that is far, which is pretty damn cool. I applaud you for that. But we still got another, you know, we still have another 500 years of lost even in his. There's the girls' site. I've been waiting for them all night. I've been waiting for them. They finally got here. They're a little late. They were going to tell me that they have followed their lineage for probably till 1973, I'm going to guess, on that site itself is where it started. You know, so when you look back, 500 years is a hell of a long time to not know where or what anything was going on. And 1500 is ridiculously awesome. It really is. The farthest lines lineage that I have before the name changes to Lines, and then Line is Thomas Lines, born in 1695 in North Hampshire, England. And so, you know, when we look at that again, I almost put AH. I saw Hot Girls and I thought, there it is. You know, they should try a different site like Horrible Girls or Horrible Guys site. They should try that. Maybe it'd work. I don't know. But you know, even as we go back, how much can we go back to who and what we are to be able to look at, okay, we still got 500, 600 years of life that we don't know. And tell me that there wasn't these connections in 1,000 years. How could there even be one group of people that could say where it's at? What is the line? There's Cookie Monster. What's up, Cookie Monster? How's it going with you tonight? How's the cookie world going? Hopefully it's well. Not the Naughty Girl app, the app that Lines use to go back. The Genealogy Center in Independence, Missouri is probably the best I've ever seen. They have a center in Independence, Missouri. If you want to go back and check out your heritage, it's a great thing to do. If you want to do that, I know where mines are going to prisons and institutions. It's pretty much, I can go there. I got an app called Prisons and Institutions, and I go back there and I can pretty much find most of my lineage. It's pretty easy to do because that's where we came from. But even at 500 years, even if you go back 500, 600, 1600, 1800, you still don't know. Repoing cookies tonight. Lots of fun repoing cookies tonight, because if you don't pay for your cookies, the Cookie Monster will come and get your cookies. That's why they call him the Cookie Monsters. So my point is that even the groups of people today, what do they know about, you know, and I won't say they don't know anything, but what do they know about what those meant 1,000 years ago, what those meant 900 years ago? You know, can we look at that kind of stuff and say, well, you know, just common sense wise, can we look at that? So here's the first I'm going to tell you, because I got a lot of people out here. It's been a lot of different places. I got a video that's just got video, a lot of stuff that I picked out of places that I've been. And I've seen a lot of petroglyphs in my time. On my mom's side, I track back to Peter Hansen Hamarkolo, born in 1525, Bornholm, Denmark. That's, man, you guys are getting way back there, way back there. That is a long ways. And so when we look at that, we look at well, what's it mean? Was there a purpose for it? And we look back and think, in Britain, he's the biscuit monster. Oh, that's probably true too. That probably is true too. So when we look back though, how much of that went forward? How much of those groups of people that are in, you know, well, is this group really Apache? Is this group really Navajo? Is this people, you know, are these Hohokam, you know, are they whatever, right? You don't know. And you don't know unless you do DNA. And you really don't know then how they evolved the next 100 years and the next 100 years and the next 100 years. And so did they change? Biscuit monster, yes. Beef eater, no. Oh, I didn't know if the cookie monster was a vegan. I didn't know, is he vegan because he eats cookies or not? He doesn't appear to be vegan, but maybe he is. I've never thought about it that way. So when we go back and we look at these things, what do we really know about them? Well, we know they started with a hole in the rock, which they ate out of, the couple, right? And so we also realize that then they evolved, right? So then you see these petroglyphs go into an archaic design where they're a design, right? So why didn't they start drawing with animals? Why did they start going in this evolution? Why do you see petroglyphs in certain different ways? Why is that? You know, why is there? There's definitely an evolution of this work that transferred into more. Now, is that similar to a pot with no painting on it and then evolving into the art form that we see as far as the designs and the paint and how important it was because they would, and again, why did they do that? Well, we think because it would make it easier to trade or more valuable, but who knows about that either? We don't know any of this stuff, but there are things that you look at and you go, wait a minute, what is this? You know, what is the fact that you don't see fish? We know they ate fish. John brings this up quite a bit. But why is there fish, right? Ancient exploring. Are you taking off already? It's early still. So why is there not fish? Why are there some different grouping? So there is some baseline that we can work off and estimate why there's this. Why is every location you go to have deer? You know, why is that? There has to be something. They had more food sources than deer. You know, but they don't have every food source on there. And so why was that? Some things are easy to look at when you see them. You know, does it look like a snake? Well, yeah, that looks like a snake. Well, maybe it's a snake. Some things aren't so curious. There's a circle that we always look at. We find it a lot of different locations. And that circle is this circle, right? And you've all seen it. And on this line, it said a spiral petroglyph and pictograph images are commonly found throughout the Southwest and are associated with wind, water, spiritual emergence, and an individual's journey through life. I don't disagree that could be it, but I don't, where's my proof? How do I, you know, and I see spirals everywhere. Spirals is a big petroglyph that when you go out, you will find spirals. But I've also heard it about the crop rotation, and I've heard it about all this stuff where we estimate what we think this stuff is and the reality of it is until somebody can prove me wrong or different. But who in the hell knows? If we're going to do this real quick, and then I'm going to show a video and I'm going to show some of this stuff. That be me. Who's that? Who'd that be right there? Who knows who that is right there? Who knows who that is? Who knows who that gentleman right there is? Who'd that be? Somebody's got that. I'm sure they do. There it is right there. Who'd that be? So as we go through this, I'm going to throw a video up here. This is just cuts that I've taken. I start thinking about how many videos I've done, not how many petroglyphs I've seen. And I'm not saying I know more than anyone else. I'm just saying that I have seen a lot. Nobody has the answers. It's all guessing. Even the archaeologist, Maria's throwing down on him. And so we're all estimating what this is. And you can look at some areas and go, wait a minute, because I have seen, not Chato, Bob. I'm not sure what if he means that or not. Maybe it's a misspell. I don't know. But a lot of people go and look at these places, and so have I. And you will find unique locations of some of these places. And some of them are incredibly different. And I'm going to throw some of them up there. And let's get this on here. And we won't watch. I've got a ton of videos on this, but I won't go in. We won't bore you with that.
And from what I've read, there's some way that they use these rocks to. I mean, it looks tiny, but that would be like a temporary shelter.
I think that is. I think so, yeah. Right here. He's
Yeah. He's got like feather wings.
The sun, something here, and is there anything on the I'm just going to step down here just to see. I think there's a great rock. I don't know. FRT, there might have been a date there that I can't read anymore. That's just incredible to think people were down here. I don't know. It looks like a kind of like.
Now this.
Yeah! Finally!
Finally, that is some absolute pottery sherds.
Wow, we have not found anything.
Dude.
Look how rough that is. There you go. There's two people.
I only left that in for one reason. That's in Sears. And I've never found a pottery sherd in Sears ever. And that thing had been on the ground for a long, long time. So I just left it in there for the hell of it.
Here it is. Three. We've not seen any out here.
Don't yell at me. I'm putting it directly back.
They're yelling at you. I can't.
Don't touch it.
Well, you know, and I can't believe you found it though. I can't
it looks
believe.
It's just like rock.
That does look like rock.
So there was, yeah, that's cool.
Wow, that's excellent. That's a great find. This little trail here was for real. You know, it wasn't. 1857! Look at that! That is awesome. Though there's one of them.
There we go.
Now there's two guys. So what were two guys doing up here, man? We're going to have to look them up and see if they come up. Hey, bam! Wow, that's awesome. Okay, now we're rolling, baby. Now we're rolling. Oh, shit, look up there. There's a bird's nest. Here, and there's no doubt that was either a fire, ceremonial fire of some type, but all the, even over there, you can tell.
Oh, there's the bow and arrow.
He's got a bow and arrow.
There's the bow and arrow guy.
So there's a newer, I wish I knew what that was.
That's a really solid bow and arrow guy.
Man, and that's the wagon. Oh, yeah, bam. Yeah.
Dude, wagon guy. It's crude, but it's absolutely a guy on a wagon.
That's crazy.
I'm going to try to get you guys a better view of that. Man, that's really
that is awesome. That is awesome. Oh, shit. Look at this panel here. Oh, my God. Oh, here's another bow and arrow man.
You got bow and arrow man?
We got another, a little more crude. But he absolutely has a bow and arrow. Not even a question. Right here.
Let me see. Oh, dude. Absolutely.
Oh, look at these kind of like bees and like these markings, like
hash marks of some sort, almost.
God, remember how excited it used to be to find petroglyphs like that, and how exciting it was when you first go out and you're looking for stuff and you've not seen it, and all of a sudden you see these petroglyphs and you're like, and you're so excited about it. You're excited about seeing these petroglyphs. And you look at it and you wonder, you know, was that done by a more of a Mesoamerican, that wagon or the guy with the bow? I mean, we know they hung around that area because the stage went right through there. So could that have been one of them? Could it have been another group from, you know, an Apache or a Navajo or any of those different groups later? And it was fun to see me get excited about that and how excited we were when we found stuff like that back in the day when it was, when doing this was brand new. And I do miss that sometimes. You get where you forget how exciting it is to see some of these petroglyphs out there that are incredible, whether it be the supernova, whether it be the warrior, whether it be man on fire, whether it be the red deer. I mean, these different groups of people, they have actually said, it's exciting to see that stuff. Digging Arizona's, I've never seen a petroglyph, tons of ruins, no petroglyphs. Man, it depends on the grouping area that you're at. If you go to Agua Fria, you'll be overwhelmed. You stay in the Verde, not as many. There's not as many. And what's that about? Also, when you talk about petroglyphs, what's that part about? You know, so why is there less than some other places? That sounded good, whatever that was. I hope it stays dormant.
I don't know if you can see that in that light. That
definitely looks like all I think I've ever seen between this whole panel.
Look, it looks like a lizard.
Oh man, it just keeps going on and on and on too. This is the most extensive panel I've ever seen. Oh my God.
Dude.
They're everywhere.
Oh, that's cool.
Look at this.
It keeps going?
It goes down and down and down.
It keeps going?
It goes down and down and down.
Kind of butterfly looking guy.
Now, one of the best panels that I have seen is Sears Point. And that was Sears Point. And so if you're new to petroglyphs, for example, and you want to see a great panel, that one there is one of the best. And then if you do follow it around, you go all the way around, there's everything there. It's a pretty fascinating sight. And then you flip back, which we're getting ready to do, and you go to some other areas on Gila Bend as well. But I've got stuff from everywhere.
Like a horn guy that's got the same similar.
There's like a thunderbird, really like weird looking thing.
That almost looks like some type of bird.
I like those long. Hair. I don't know.
No, that's a long tail, like either a mountain lion or a jaguar. Now, supposedly there is a glyph up here somewhere that has a jaguar and a dead man.
The curled tail. I remember the other video. He talks about that being something he read about.
Now there are jaguar / mountain lion stuff over at Sears Point that we saw. This is a beautiful piece right here. Cool. That is cool.
Perfect with the real company.
Just got done.
Now that was Quail Point, and there's another one we're going to go drop into, and a lot of you guys have seen this, but I pulled this up because, you know, this has got the cardinal points, and this is down in this kind of ravine, inset on Quail Point. And it has one of the most fabulous cardinal points on sitting in this area where it appears that you would maybe be looking at the stars. I'm not sure. Again, that's just my own take. But what fascinated me and why I put this in there is because it showed the directions, and we checked it with the compass, and it was pretty damn accurate when we put it on there.
This is the directional, you know, the directions.
Yep.
So if that's accurate, it'd be north.
Yep, there's the ancient compass.
West, east, south. And you know what? I'd actually say in my head, this is exactly accurate, is what's scary. I would say this thing is right to the T.
So this is pretty much spot on perfect with the real compass. Modern compass is lining up almost directly with the cardinal directions here. That's pretty spectacular.
You said spectacular, James!
That is unbelievable.
That is.
So there's a petroglyph that we know has some value of showing some type of cardinal point directions, some purpose for that. We do know that it wasn't just a fluke that the cardinal points were there. And when you put the compass to it, it looked at it. So we can't say that petroglyphs don't somewhat have some purpose. Now, we don't know exactly why or what, but that's a good point on that one. It was not art. There's a purpose for that. There's a reason why they built that like they built that. And it had a purpose for them for some reason. Now, what? You know, who knows? It's very difficult to tell. Again, when you go past that, you're guessing. But when you see that and it matches up with a compass, you know that, okay, so then you can take liberties and go, okay, was this an area that they used to look at the sky? And would they study the stars from down here? Would they know certain specific reasons why those cardinal points were important to them? And you know, then you can take this liberty, but the reality of it is you don't know that until, you know, past the point of knowing exactly what it is. Does it point the way it's supposed to? Yes. Does it look like some way to be able to tell which direction? Yes. Past that, though, you don't really know. But that was one of my favorite ones, because when we put that compass on it and it was accurate, it was like, oh my gosh, now this symbol has purpose of some type. Now, again, do we know exactly what it is? No, we do not know what exactly it is, but we could tell that it does have some more value than that.
Right there, man. How cool is that? Because Alex.
And from what circles do they take?
I'm going to say that's a roadrunner. I don't know what these are. This is a weird one right here, too. All of definitely archaic stuff. There's something over here I'm going to take a look at. Saw that. Nice little panel right there. And then over here, oh, that's cool. Little kind of Cro-Magnon. You know, not everybody was a great antelope or deer hunter, drawer, I should say. They weren't perfect. There's a nice panel up here that you need to see. News is that since we found that, the group of people put it. So, you know, the good news is that since we found that one, we should be able to find the rest of these as we hike down this canyon.
Now, with that one there, and a lot of people will say, I call it the sun because it looked like a sun to me. A lot of people say it's a lot different from that, right? Now, for example, if you're looking at this stuff and you're trying to estimate or guesstimate what it is, one thing that you'll notice when you go to that location, that's Agua Fria, and that's a special one to me because we'd search for that high and low. But what makes it incredible is that you see this design. It's by itself. There's nothing close. It looks like that rock could have actually been moved there. I don't know if it had or it hadn't, but it looks like it could have been. It would have been a hell of a task, but, you know, it looked like it was moved to the location. And then if you looked at that area and you study the area, you'll realize that that has been terraced. That area around that has been terraced. And so when you look at it and you go, okay, they had a terrace in here and they were growing food here. And so is that a sun, this hoping the sun god will shine on him? I don't know. I mean, that's a guess. A lot of people say that's not a sun. They'll say it's something else. But I always thought that was incredible that piece is in the middle of nowhere. It's not near anything else. And then when you get up there and you realize that is a terraced location that people, they grew their crops there. It makes it different. I mean, it doesn't mean that's it. But when you see things like that, you start to estimate and guesstimate what you think it could possibly be because what's the surrounding. But then again, you're also guessing. And so, but that is a spectacular petroglyph. There are some petroglyphs out there that my gosh, when you see them, they mean something to you because somebody spent a lot of time making sure that thing had the value that it had. You don't see them the quality of that. When you see this petroglyph, it is a superior quality in people and it's deep. Somebody took a lot of time and energy and to show importance to it, definitely did.
Yeah.
It's got like a reddish tint to it.
Now, pictograph and petroglyph, right? Or a combination of both, because and you don't see them in that area where that's painted, right? That's a red paint. So it looks like up there, they just didn't draw them. Now you'll see pictographs that will be drawn creatures or things or items that are drawn on the rock. Up there, they tend to actually do a petroglyph and then paint the petroglyph. And you see that on just a small amount of places up there. And when you realize that dye that they build or paint, whatever you want to call it, lasted, you know, 800 years when you can't get a paint on your back wall in Phoenix to last three. It's amazing to think about that. And then the purpose of why were those, you know, there's probably, I'm going to go 9 or 10 that I know of, pictographs on that ridge. And why? And that's it. You don't see them and never seen them anywhere else. And it doesn't mean that they're not there, because in that area, you can find anything, and you can be the guy that finds stuff in Agua Fria. That's what makes that place spectacular, is that you can be the guy to see something that only maybe a handful of people, and maybe not anybody within the last 100 years, has even seen it. And that's what makes that cool. But then when you look at it and you're evaluating it, you're not judging it, but you're evaluating it. So why are there only a limited amount of these pictographs? And maybe there were more, because there are some that you can kind of tell look like the paint didn't last. There's a couple over by Supernova that look like they potentially could have had some type of paint on it, but I don't know that to be a fact. So why did they paint those deers red there? Why did they paint Man on Fire? Why is that only like the one guy there? Now, in that area, there's probably six more also, but not, you know, but why? So was there a purpose? And was it the same person that did those petroglyphs or pictographs? Is there a style? Can you see a style? Was it a trade style? Was it a culture style? Was it an individual style? Or was it the same damn guy that did all of them? You know, that's the stuff that's really hard. My clock is probably close, chasing Eric off to bed early. I hope Eric didn't go to bed thinking it was late. Maybe he did. That AH, that's actually a pretty good point. I'll have to change that. That might have been what got him out. He might have went, oh my God, I got to get up and I got to go to bed. So those are the things that I find intriguing when you're looking at this stuff.
Well, that's it right there. Look at that. Look at that.
An Arizona pictograph. And there's the second one.
Is there anything else down there? James, we got to figure out how James. It looks like a good trail, though, all the way.
The sun doesn't do it any favors.
You see those?
Nothing special? Right. Careful now.
God dang.
Okay. Especially when you're into
there is Man on Fire right there. The light was playing a little harshness with us, but that is Man on Fire.
Especially when you're into it
like you. Well, that's the Man on Fire as well.
There is Man on Fire.
There's another two men on fire.
Whoa.
And there's incredible Hare.
The sun doesn't do it any favors.
You see those dots up there? James, you see those dots?
Oh, yeah.
They were up there.
I actually have that loaded there, Steve, somewhere. I'll show that.
I got a picture of that. With,
so that was a... So that was a
pot. Hey, somebody dropped.
And I'm telling you, they dug it out of there. There's no doubt in my mind. See, this is a pot. I don't know if you probably knew that, but look at that. You don't see.
I'm gonna go in there.
You don't see.
And there
the rare is glyph, apparently. So the duck. I mean, we have yet to stumble.
Hey, be careful there.
And for example, on that one, the duck. It was more about finding it. It was that elusive petroglyph that we took, and it took journeys to find it just to say that you found it. It wasn't spectacular. It kind of looks, and then you have other guys that are down there looking at it and they tell you, well, you know, that's not the only duck at Pado. And you're like, what? No, that's not the only duck. We were looking for this and we found another duck and another duck. And then I throw a couple of feelers out there. Is there more ducks in Pado than one? Yeah, well, that kind of ruined the whole thing. But you know what? It is what it is. It's offensive to assume that petroglyphs gender. I have to, because I didn't want to call it woman on fire. So I had to. I think his pronoun was man, I think. That is not difficult, Steve, to get to that. It's not. It's just they did it right down there. They make you stop and walk in. You got to walk in about a half mile. It's a flat hike. It's simple. It is a special place though. And again, when you go to these places enough, you realize that there is a different style and a different look in some of these places that you get, if you go to Pado. I miss these adult dating sites. Dang it. So there was an error. There was an error. So, I mean, you do see different, you absolutely see different styles in different locations. You really do. You do see, I don't know why it won't let me block the adult chat. Maybe I'm supposed to call them. I don't know. Who knows? Put them in timeout then. Yeah, I can at least do that. And so you do go to different places and you see a different style. There's no doubt. You see the basic deer all over everywhere, but you get into places like down by Tucson, that place is ridiculous. I mean, the butte it's got its own world. It's not like anywhere else. It's not like anywhere else, which is incredible. And so, you do know that there had to be something more special here, but you don't know exactly what it is. Let me see if I've got a video of that real quick.
Did come from here. Maybe it fell off the top up here. Ledge right here. Definitely you see more petroglyphs than you've seen all the way through any of this. And you go to a section and then you see nothing, and then you go to this section. Man, look at all this. They're everywhere through here. So what made this area so special? It's incredible. It really is.
I like the square-headed guy.
What you see. And all these panels. Okay, there's James climbing up right there. Now, what we found is probably one of the coolest finds that I can't even believe this. There is a ram or an antelope there that's red.
Yeah, we definitely know these are up here.
There's red here. There's red on this deer and there's red on this deer. And then if you go up to this point right there, there's red on that. So there's three that have been painted. And I don't know, there might have been more. And then again, I can't even show you this because I can't get back far enough. This is the biggest deer I've ever seen up here. See how big this thing is, James? And then here's a smiley face. Now, I'm not sure what to think about the smiley face, to be honest with you. And then there's one of the coolest deers I've seen over here also. So, there's a smiley face, whatever that is. And there is a pheasant. There's a pheasant. See
or
that?
A quail, I should say.
See that.
And then this deer down here is one of the best deers. That looks like somebody did it. Yet. Look at that. Wow. They climbed way up in that corner. So they had something up in there. That would be a place if you were a good climber to get up in there, because they were up in that corner. I don't have the climbing skills and ability, and they'd probably be pretty pissed off at me if I did, but I'm tempted. Look at that, right there. pulled up. So, you know, when you think you're out here in the middle of nowhere and nobody's been here, look at that pole top right there. So somebody's been down in this area, or they just threw it off. But I didn't bring my gun. So the good news is, if it was a cat, holy shit, that was crazy. So here's what I wanted to see. Look at that piece right there.
The only reason I put that in there, you almost saw my demise right there. I almost went off that cliff. It was pretty damn close. I was, I just threw that in there because I was like, I remember when I went off that cliff. Now down below was this cave, this rock cropping. And you could tell that there had been, a mountain lion or something making tracks. I mean, that path was worn. And I was like, man, I didn't have my gun, but I was like, I almost didn't need anything because I almost become bait. I went down. That was about 6 feet. It didn't seem like it. And then I just, when I got to the edge, my boots just caught the edge of the rock. And it was almost like, okay, that was about my last petroglyph stop that I ever made right there. That's the only reason I threw that in there, just for fun, so you guys see me in turmoil.
Is that incredible or what?
That's all that fucking matters.
There it is, right there. Wow, look at that. Now, look at that also right there. It's hard to get out of, y'all try to get out of your light. Out. That's a little guy right. Now there's a beautiful archaic design right there. Okay. So now I can see that we have very simple, really critters over here. That
now, see, this is where you were talking. I almost just died on camera, anyways. Look at the shirt. Well, what else are you gonna do other than what a dumbass? I almost went off the edge of the, and I almost did. It was like I've never been like standing on a cliff base like that, and I just went. I mean, it just, the rock started rolling, and I was getting down there to get that. That's why I was going down there. I was like, well, yeah, I almost died. It was close, but it didn't. Here is your location, Mr. Lyons.
Petroglyph right there.
This is the, oh, wow. See there. Oh, wait a minute. Stop that right there. Okay. Here, see that guy right there, the devil guy right there. Okay. See the devil guy right there. There's the same devil guy at Pado with the same face. And if you blow it up, they look evil as hell. And there's the same, it's exactly the same face, which is almost weird. Like, okay, wait a minute. If you look at the warrior, if you got pictures of the warrior at Pado and you get his face really big, he is hideous. Now, I don't know if it's just the way the rock was, or they actually made it like that. And I would have said that, except for the fact when I took this one here.
Those guys. That guy right there, they're pretty.
These guys right here, man, they had the same evil face. And when you get them things larger. Now, this is Flower World, they call this, where it's all, where they believe that this was a sacred site. And again, it's all guesses, but this is where the bell rocks are at, which is incredible.
Mean. Look at that. You know, that almost looks like some type of scripture to a certain degree, as funny as that might sound to you guys. Just the way that's laid out. I've seen a lot of petroglyphs in my time. I can say that I'm pretty fortunate to be, I'm not K, but I've seen a lot. And I've not seen anything like this. I have not seen anything with the distinctive lines like that. That is absolutely incredible. Right there. That is unreal. Zoomorphic, anamorphic, archaic. I mean, you've got definitely different generations of what I believe will be Hohokam.
Look in behind here. Look at that. Look at that shot right there. Isn't that unbelievable? Look at that. Wow. That was worth the climb down. And that's something, these are, look at the small one here. There's a large one and there's a small one. Wow, how incredible is that? You know, I was going to come down that way. That would have been fairly hairy if I'd arisen and went down that way. But how neat is that? Look at that picture right there. That is a cool picture.
See, and that's the thing about, is they're all over. And a lot of times you can't see them. And if you are ever on a wall like that and you see overhang that rubs up against it, please cut it off and get the branches away from the petroglyphs if you get a chance, especially like that one. Nobody's seen that thing, and I don't even know when, you know, how long it'd been since somebody had even seen that. And again, that's what makes places like Agua Fria so special, is that you can go there and you can find stuff that nobody's seen. You know, my buddy Angelo, he was looking for the sun, and then he found what I call hands up. It looks like the first robbery that happened in Agua Fria, because the guy's hands are straight up. So that's what I called it, was hands up. That was the first robbery that they ever put on there. But he's found that because he's looking for another one, and we'd never seen that one ever. Thank you, Mr. Lines. I appreciate it. I appreciate you. Thank you, and have a happy Thanksgiving. I appreciate all that, and thank you very much. Much appreciated, sir. And we'll kick this. It's about done.
Let's look our way back over here. Wow. Like a mountain goat right there.
Now, one thing I want to tell you real quick is that don't look steep. Here's the deal. When you're up there and you see that grass and it's dead, it's like skating rink. So remember that when you get on stuff like that, that you're in. And there was another cliff wall right there, because that was the same place in the same area that I about took the ride off the wall. What's there's comes a little bear. What's up, man? That picture of the line showed the emergence from the fourth world of our Hopi beliefs. A reed comes from underworld into this world. Emergence from the third world. The place where those were at, flower, they call it Flower World. And that was supposed to be its own semi-religion, is what they estimated or guesstimated. And who knows? I mean, they're making stuff up. Oh, I like that sound, whatever that sound was. Sounded good. That area has a completely different feel than anywhere else does. It really does. And when you go down there and you have all those bell rocks, and again, if you ever go there, call me, get a hold of me, because there's three locations down there. And most people don't know that there's three, because I walked that entire thing, and there might even be more, but I found three. So there's multiple different mounds. There's the big mountain, which has them on the southwest side. And they're massive. And then there's other little mounds, and then there's a whole structure that is just bell rocks on this littler mound. And so if you decide to go to any of these locations, give me a holler and I'll help you find some of this stuff. So if there's anywhere that you guys want to go on any of this stuff, and there's so many things to choose from and so many cool locations. One of the fun things that we really enjoyed doing was going and finding these ones like the Man on Fire. That was a special one because we just stumbled on it, and it got named Man on Fire, and people call it Man on Fire. You know, people ask me about Man on Fire, and I thought like hair on fire. So that was kind of cool when people call it that. Another one that I don't have any is the Hopi Princess. The Hopi Princess is one of the best petroglyphs I've ever seen anywhere. And it's the only one I've ever seen in any of Agua Fria or any of Gila Bend or anywhere in the state of Arizona. I personally have seen, I'm not saying it's not out there, but has the Hopi dress attire on, and then the girl has her hair up in those buns, and you do not see that with that detail. That's what, and that was one of the hardest petroglyphs that we ever found or had to find because of the extreme hike that we had to get to it. But see, that changes to me all of it also, because that shows to me that that there were Hopi in there in that area. And even though they say that there's a lot of different stuff, that's what makes it cool is when you get down there and you go, okay, this place is special. This is not your normal deal. Jay said that was Richard Pryor on fire. But you know, that's what makes it cool when you see these locations and you get to go to these and you realize that this was a special place. You don't have to be able to read what a petroglyph you think it is or what it isn't if you're not qualified, like I'm not. But I can see them and appreciate the fact that they're special or they're different or they're unique. You know, when you've seen as many as I have and you go to places and you see different styles that you do not see anywhere else, and even in the same location, again, I go back to Pado. And you guys know why I believe that Pado was the warrior site, because there's all masculine petroglyphs and it's all war type scenarios. And there is a picture of a warrior there. And there's also the biggest picture that you're ever got, the biggest petroglyph that you will see in Agua Fria. One of the biggest I've ever seen anywhere is a man that's almost full size. And it's incredible to be able to go, I've never seen one that big. And it's looking down the hill. And, you know, again, what my thought process was, yeah, it's telling you, you come up this hill and you're not going to come back down. And if this doesn't warn you, then you're in big trouble. And so when you look at that stuff, yeah, you, and again, am I right or wrong? It's my guess, right? It's my guess. But I can tell you from what I've seen, I can tell you that you don't see stuff like that. You don't see the big hands, big feet guys all over Agua Fria. You know, they are focused into the shaman's cave, which is a shaman's cave right there. There's two shaman caves at Pado. There's one there, and there's also a small one at Supernova. And you can, you know, especially the one at Pado. And, you know, again, why do I think it could be a warrior's? Well, it has has the big rock. It has three rocks that actually are used for building spears and arrows. And you know that that's how they boil water and they bent the wood and straightened the wood on the rock, which is, you know, and so, you know, they were manufacturing goods to whether you want to say that's to hunt or to protect themselves or a combination of both. You don't get that anywhere else. You don't get that feel anywhere else. So there are some things that you go, wow, this is a special place. And Squaw, where the Hopi princess is at, that's incredible. That's worth the climb down to the bottom of the hole, but you better be ready for an ass kicking on the way back up. But it's incredible. I mean, it's one of them ones that it's so special, it's unbelievable. You know, but that's what's cool about this is, you know, you can almost collect petroglyphs like you collect matchbook covers. How's that, John? Matchbook covers, almost the same. And it's pretty cool to be able to say that, you know, it's pretty cool to just for me to go, you know, I've seen both supernovas. I saw the one in Chaco and I saw the one in Agua Fria. Not a lot of people can say that. And to me, it's special. And so when we talk about petroglyphs again, I had it in here. I wonder where it's at. I mean, I might have passed by. I may not have. I
want to physical see geology. Remember Black Flag, don't you?
I want to see if I can.
Oh, there's my man right there.
Oh, yeah.
My favorite. Yes, look at these two.
Right there with the
there's the warrior. Hands.
I love that guy.
With one of my favorites right there.
I even said
I that. Think there's.
I'm looking for a three. There, look at
okay,
that.
Here, and then the dots here. Everywhere.
You don't see these men like that. And you see a lot of dots that, on that area as well. There's a whole wall of them. But you see these guys to me that look like warriors. But I'm actually looking for Supernova is the one I'm looking for. Only because why do I think Supernova is that? It's because you don't see that anywhere. And I don't know where it's at. I don't know if it's for that or not. But so Supernova doesn't look like there's Hari 12345 12345. He didn't get a five for some reason. Somehow that happened where he didn't get a five because he was bad. We had a good day that day when Hari came in from San Diego. We had an awesome day that day, you know. And one of the advantages we had was that, you know, he got to experience like five sites that you would not be able to do unless you knew where you were going. So he got the advantage of us being able to take him to, we took him to Squaw to see the red deer. We took him to Brooklyn to see Man on Fire. We took him to Pado. We took him to Supernova. We took him to the Sun. I mean, we did all that in one day, which is a full day. And again, that's something that took us 5, 6, 7 months to be able to do. Ever thought about using a drone to help you scout for sites? The problem is the FBI doesn't want me having a drone. Now that's a weird story, but, it's the truth. They don't want me driving a drone. I get a lot of hate mail, because we were some of the first people to go out and start, documenting these sites. And a lot of people got very, very pissed off about it. And, you know, I get one side of it and I don't, you know, the other one side is that if we cherish our history and we cherish our cultures and we appreciate and respect them, I think we'll just be better people for it. Some people believe that you shouldn't, and you shouldn't get to see it. And, you know, that's their opinion. It's kind of funny. I put on there, should sites be fenced off, or should they be open and well managed? And 20% of the people said they should be shut down. There is still 2 out of 10 people, even on this channel, that believe that they should be shut down. And so there's still a group of people that believe that, you know, they should be. I just believe that, I believe differently than that. I believe that, you know what? And I also believe that there's no secrets. Most everything I ever found was on the internet. Now I've stumbled off a couple things, but most of this stuff was just done by research, and they gave me the research. You know, there's groups out there that are fighting me going to them when they gave me the information they find them. You know, I checked the dig sites that they had out there, and I was like, you know, you're the guys that told me where this is at. Now you're telling me I can't go there when you gave me a report that told me exactly where it was at. I mean, you know, I had some help with Rockman, but most of it, I knew where I was in the area because I read a dig report. And it's like, you guys gave me this information. You guys told me where it was at. Now you're telling me I can't go there when you told me, hey, there's where it's at, but don't go there. He drones and drives. Drone bad, very bad. Dean, what's up? Good to see you, brother. The FBI doesn't want me to have a drone, dude. Explain more. I had the FBI call me, and I'll about drones. And that started a war between me and another group of people. And even though I don't have a drone, never wanted to own a drone. I will tell anybody out there. So if you don't know, if you have a drone and they make sizes that are small enough where you do not have to, have a license to fly, you don't have to have a license if it's a small size. Okay. But if you have monetization on your videos, then you have to have a license. So that's the catch. And I know the only, and so you got to remember, there's groups of people that were after me, because they thought I was the most horrible person ever because I was showing videos of places, and they didn't know how to act. I was the first guy that actually kind of went out and started to show stuff. And man, a lot of people were pissed off about it. And, you know, it was like, hey, you know, and then you got in this war between them. And I get every side. I understand both sides. I just don't believe that I shouldn't be able to go there. I mean, again, that's my opinion, but I do respect the ones that say the same thing. They say the opposite. They say the 20% says, hey, you know, you shouldn't go there. You shouldn't get to go there. And I'm a little different. I just think that I should. I think that it's my history as well. I mean, this is where I live. This is my history as well. I don't have to be directly associated with it to understand it, to protect it, and to respect it, and to make sure it's there for the next generation. And I don't think you do that. I don't think you do that by thinking and hoping that somebody doesn't find it. You know, there's two sides of this. I have conversations with people that shouldn't be talking to me. I have conversations with law enforcement that will tell you that they never talked to me. And so they tell me the truth of what's going on, right? Because they understand sometimes it's just stupidity. But they'll tell me that it's good to see me there because I know that somebody's watching it. And if nobody ever goes there, then a guy can go there and dig and do the things he's not supposed to be doing if nobody knows about it. And so the secret sometimes is the same thing that kills them. But I know there's a fine line on that, right? And I do understand if you have a sensitive site that's right by the road, you probably need to do something about it. You know, you might think that. John's going to say FJ Cruiser. And there's Tim. I appreciate you, my brother. Thank you very much. Look at that petroglyph he's got on there. Look at that dude. That's awesome. Thank you, man. I appreciate you. I really do. I don't even know if I still got my Wendy video. I don't know if that's still, I don't even know if I still got that or not. Dang it. It's probably not there, but I wish I did. I'd play that. That was funny as hell. I don't even think I got it loaded up. I got too many videos in here. Dang it. I wish I had that. Tim, I appreciate having you back and thank you for that. That means the world to me. I'm much obliged. Had a lot of great times with Tim. We had a lot of fun. And so we'll have to get back out. We'll all have to get back out and do the dance. I know other people are kind of involved in other stuff. It makes it difficult, but I get it. And as long as, you know, even the people that stem from this channel that came here, that, you know, I people that know me, they know who and what I am. They know what I'm about. And the ones that don't know me, well, they can judge me however they want. That's their opinion. But the people that know me, they understand. Man, it's good to have you back, Tim. I missed you, man. I really did. There's a group of us that really did all the different stuff. When are we having a group hike out? You know, I don't know. You know, one of my good internet friends, we're not personal friends, but we are good internet friends. Man, there is a bunch of stuff in the Superstition Mountains, The problem is, it's so brutal to get into those places. And that's why they're probably pristine, because it's going to be a bear to get in there. I still got to get a group of people that want to go do the cliff dwellings. We've got to get that done. You know, I can have anybody else. I still love the drone, but you know, it just wasn't worth the, you know, they were after me and they're trying to get me, and, you know, and I'll remember that. I've got my ace in the hole, and it's so big. I've got two aces. I think I got three aces actually. So whenever it comes down, it'll come down pretty. But you know, Red Rock's another beautiful place that is absolutely gorgeous, man. It is gorgeous because it doesn't fit, you know? And I understand that Sedona is the Red Rock Villa because it was underwater. So was the Gila underwater there as well at one time? And I would say yes, only because how did that rock structure get there? Another thing we were talking about today is that, you know, it is Gila Bend, that would have been a massive bend where that river would have pushed out pretty far before it came around. But there's stuff all the way down. If you follow that river, if you follow Gillespie and you track down, there is stuff all the way to Yuma. And people are like, no, yeah, there is. So, you know, but there's also, you know, you go up to Agua Fria or Verde Valley. I mean, I got 53 sites in Verde Valley that I haven't hit yet. I think we've hit three of them. And so we got 53. We're sitting on probably 800 sites right now. And, you know, just getting to them is, you know, and then, you know, you do one like, the Devil's, Cavern and you look at those, man, they're going to be a hike. But yeah, I mean, we've had a lot of fun. I'll tell you a trip I really enjoyed, was Verde, when we did the Verde and figured out when to cross that the Cavites are one beautiful, even though you don't see the petroglyphs again. It's an incredible place. Those places just aren't, you know, I remember finding that for the first time and reading about this stuff. It was so incredible when I was on that journey, trying to find these things and the exploring and to feel like it was the first time that I'd, you know, it was the first time I'd been there, but just how cool that was to plot that stuff out and looking at all the petroglyphs I've had the opportunity to see. you know, it doesn't make you an expert, but it does give you a pretty good idea what's out there. And so, you know, when you look at different things, you know, there is things like, why is there all these deers? Why is there not a lot of amphibian, you know, fish, things like that, frogs? You don't see that stuff, right? And a lot of people will tell you, well, it's because something about the spirit world, but you don't really know that. I mean, a lot of it's guesstimation and estimation. So, you know, that's where it's intriguing to see that kind of stuff, but it's out, you know, it's out there. There's a thing about this state that you just don't get anywhere else, man. It is incredible. What's out there, and we haven't scratched the surface, man. We have not scratched the surface. You know, you could almost just take any creek bed in anywhere in the state of Arizona and walk it. And even if it's dry, but if it's been there for a while, you're going to find stuff. Because they're going to be wherever the water was. This place was so huge when it came to ancient stuff, you know, and so you're going to find, and again, Agua Fria is a place that you can go up there today. And if you really wanted to spend, you could spend a year there and it'll beat your ass as well. Jeff went to, he went to the Badger Springs ruin and he's like, and I told him, I said, dude, it's going to look like it's a sissy hike right across the meadow. You know, it's a ways, but I mean, you're going to say, oh, it's just rolling hills. But I said, by the time you get done, your legs are going to feel like they're going to fall off your body. And I know in his head, he was probably thinking, well, I don't think he'd tell me that for no reason. But then he called me when he came back and he said, this is the horrible worst. Cause you can't see it's lava fields with grass. And so you can't see your foot stepping down. And so every time you get to it, man, your feet, you're going like this, man, and you're twisting your ankles. And at first you can get out there and it's not that big a deal. But when you do it again, like walking back and you're wanting to just get back to the car, oh my gosh, it's horrible. I mean, it is horrible, but it has some of the greatest things. And, you know, again, we're looking at, there's five sites at Agua Fria right now that have been found that I've never been to. And three of them are not small. And then there's a couple that are just way out there that are just like, you know, another level. I mean, they're another level to go to the fort, Squaw Fort. That's another level. I mean, you better bring your Wheaties that day, but there's two massive, I say massive, there's three massive ones, that are there that I've never been in. And so every time I think that I've seen all of them, or I think I've seen a lot of them, somebody will pop something out. Somebody will say, hey, did you ever look over here? Then I look on Google Earth and I'm like, oh my gosh, there's something down there. How in the hell are we going to get down there? You know, because remember in Agua Fria, it's a line of sight. And so they had that thing pegged all the way around through the rivers. And if you could, which you could, but it would be a lot of work. You need to walk the entire creek beds all the way around that, all the way around that circle, and all the way around that mesa. And you're talking about a truckload of work, but you would find stuff all the way through there again, because it's a line of sight. They had forts all the way along there, and you're going to stumble into forts down there that you didn't know existed, because I know people that have. They had lookout posts all along there, so they could see all the way around there what was coming on. Now, they wouldn't have lookouts for people that were not worrying about the fact that somebody was going to come get them, you know? So these line of sights were definitely in there because they were very fearful. So could some of the petro, you know, again, that's why I had the whole thing about Pato being being where they dispersed the groups when somebody was coming to attack. And that was and again, that's my estimation, guesstimation. Why would I say that? It's centrally located and it has masculine petroglyphs that don't look like anything else up there at all. And they are serious. And the rest of them, you know, they don't stumble into just oddball. They all have this purpose. And there's a pretty good sized shield down there too, about halfway down that mountain, if you're crazy enough to go down there. So there are petroglyphs that go all the way down that ridge. Cause they, in my thinking is, other than I believe they threw people off there, I had a vision on that. That's really what happened. I was on the other side, and I just imagined, oh, this is what happens here. This is what they take care of these people. So they just pitch them off the top when they have problems with them. So we, this is how we keep the orders. Blondie said something. I miss Blondie stuff. Good boots. Let me get back with Blondie. The big best rig for off-roading. You know, a lot of people, you know, man, everybody. My dad run a Ford forever. I've run a Toyota. John's run a Toyota. Like I said, my dad's had Fords. I have friends that have Jeeps. And you know, I had a Hummer at one time that I loved. And because the ride was so good, it was good at off-road. And then again, when you're talking off-road again, there's a couple different areas. And I have not broken down in any remote areas. And one thing about it, and we talked about doing this, is there's things that you need to make sure that you have. If you are going to go out, and you're especially going to go out in an area where you could break down, you know, you need a jumper box. You need to make sure that you have spare and it's got air in it. And there's things that, and you need enough food and water to know that you can walk back from anywhere that you came in there. And anytime you go in, you got to remember you might have to walk out. I remember when we was in Ajo, it was 18 miles to the, it was actually 19 or 20 miles to the Petroglyphs site, but 18 driving and then 2 hiking in. And I kept thinking, man, if we break down, this is going to be a hell of a hike. And then they had that thing where you could call for help out in the middle of nowhere. And I was like, oh, that's awesome. Because if we get broke down, I can just call. We don't have to hike out of here. And so where are we at now? Super duties are not good. Super duties are a little stiff, I think. But yeah, I mean, that's the thing too, is that it's a whole process of getting to a lot of these places as well. And yeah, you're going to have flats on occasion. You're going to have things happen. So you better be ready. You know, you got to be ready to do the dance, because I mean, it's going to be definitely an issue if you get out there and you can't get back in. But you know, if you're doing it on the weekends too, you're most likely going to run into other vehicles. There's not too many places you're in the middle of nowhere anymore, not with the amount of UTVs that are out there and the fact that that's crazy in itself. So yeah, there's no doubt that that's definitely a place that, you know, you need to be prepared, to have to hike out in case that possibly happens. I don't think I've got anything back on the,
as funny as that might sound to you guys.
Right here, I'm going to get these branches.
We steady rock, so we should be able to beat on.
That is.
I mean, I guess that's the theory.
Yeah, bro.
What's funny about that one is that's in South Mountain Park, and there was a geology class, I think, from ASU in 1905 or something. I just thought that was weird they were out there and did that.
Well, they didn't have bro. What'd they have? You think they had bro? You think that?
They had a different name, but they were bros.
They were bros. Okay.
Generations had bros.
Find this, you get a free t-shirt. That caused that.
There's
that.
Oh, that's a bad day right there.
Oh, there's my man right there. Or the
one. Oh, look at those dogs, man.
Because they were semi-archaic.
I would like to find for you guys the
what mom was doing all that for. You know. There's ruins on the top. And there's a whole group of ruins through here.
Here.
Here's another circle here. So now
that's
looking at this.
Yeah, but I mean, yeah, they're all over. And if you get a chance to look at them, and here's the thing, I don't know what they mean. You know, I have no idea what any of this stuff means. You know, it's all a guess. I can have these great theories like I have at Pato. I do have some like theories to back myself up on of why they're where they are or what they are. And you know, whether it be the sun or whether that be the supernova. I mean, one thing I'll tell you about the supernova is it looks like pictures of the supernova, though. So if you look at pictures of the supernova and you look at that petroglyph, they're identical. And so that's when I went, well, wait a minute. I mean, this is science of today saying this is what it looks like. And this is what this guy drew on this rock. And they're identical. They're close enough where you're like, oh, yeah. Could it be just a, you know, something? Yeah, it could be, but it's definitely looks like what it's supposed to look like. And there's not another petroglyph in any area I've ever been that looks like that. Even Chaco's doesn't look that cool. Chaco's is pretty lame. I hate to say it, but it's pretty lame. I think they spent more of their time building stuff than they did petroglyphs. There's some petroglyphs there, but not like you would think for a other than the fact that maybe there weren't that many people there that would be the ones that would be doing it. And then at Chaco, they don't tell you the whole story anyway. There's some stuff that they've got petroglyphs they won't show you as well. It's weird. I mean, a lot of this stuff doesn't make any sense, but maybe it's not supposed to. And that's what's cool about a place like Agua Fria or Gila Bend or Verde Valley is that you can, you know, you're free to roam. You might run into some personal property stuff in Verde on some private property, but you won't in Gila Bend, and you won't, you will in Gila Bend. I'll take that back, but not on any of the sites that we went on, other than they're trying to keep you out. They're trying to keep you off the area or off the land. Again, they're the 20%, which, you know, who knows? I mean, I get it. But, you know, if you need to go, there's ways to get into those locations without trespassing as well. You know, just because the road, you can't take the road doesn't mean you can't hike in, because the land itself is not private or not off limits, because that would make them look bad. Now the road getting in is, but not the way to get, not the way you can hike in. And there's other roads to get in. There's multiple roads to get into a lot of those locations. You don't have to take the normal path going in. So there's ways to get in. If you want to know where that's at, email me. jacereckler@yahoo.com. I am going to make sure I put that up there so you guys can see. And then what I put this up here, and I end up having a lot of opportunities to get my extended warranty taken care of. I don't even see it right there, so I'll just write it in instead. How's that? Chaco was a mall. Yeah, it's not as bad if you get out. You know, if you get out of the mall area, and there is a lot of non-mall area there, but you got to kind of know. And that's the problem with a lot of that stuff. You don't find out till later. I'm getting ready to do another Chaco video, and on some beliefs that I have, they're a little left to center. I know that people that know me find that hard to believe. If you need to get a hold of me, that's the best way to get a hold of me. I'm not good on Facebook as much because I don't do that a lot. But if you need to get a hold of me for any reason, or you're looking for something or whatever, jacereckler@yahoo.com. I don't need an extended warranty. So if you're doing that, I'm okay with that. Is the extended warranty should be good. But if you need to get a hold of me, that's the fastest way to get a hold of me right there. And like I said, I'm accessible. So if there's any questions you have about stuff outside of this group or whatever, let me know, and I'll hook you up. And all I ask you to do is be respectful and leave it like you found it, and go have fun and enjoy it, man. That's what this stuff is all about. Hiking is good. You know, there's been a lot of that, there has been so much stuff and they can, and I understand they're catch 22 up there. They want all these people to come in, and then they don't want them to be there once they're there, you know? So it's a catch 22 up there. There's a lot of places in Sedona you can still get to that's kind of off the grid or out of the area, but you know, you're not going to be alone there pretty much anymore. Not since they had the guy post that, every hiking trail and every ruined site that you could ever dream of. But I'll help anybody find whatever they need to do. Extended warranty, 1974 Pinto. Call ends quickly every time. Yeah, it could be in quickly if you get rear-ended, especially. You know what would be cool? If I get an inspirational message from Jay Sayer, I think that would make my life. You know, you can get an inspirational message. Hopefully it makes your life not worse. I get on these paths, and I do. I get people and I do that. And I sit down, and a lot of people ask me, are they all the same? No, they're not. They're actually different. You know, I won't say that I won't, if I have a good message, I won't send it to more than one person, I should say, but mostly they're dialed in for each one. Yeah, that's the least I can do is to share the world. And I appreciate all you guys. You guys are taking care of me, and it's much appreciated. Again, I would like to thank, I would like to thank Eric with Ancient Explorer. And I will see if that clock, I bet he saw that clock. I bet you're right, AH. I bet he saw that clock. And Mr. Lyons, I appreciate that. And Tim, good to have you back, brother. Thank you very much. I hope you're well. I hope you're well. And I think we'll call this night a night. I'll play this video right here one more time. So Steve Lyons can say see his name in lights, because he was the only one that was in lights.
What side am I on? What side am I supposed to be on? I never know.
YouTube famous right there. That's YouTube famous, Steve Lyons. John D. Yeah, that's a great thing. I wanted to say to everybody, have a great Thanksgiving. Hopefully you spend time with your family. Hope you're able to get out and enjoy this this great weather we're having, and be safe. And I will check you guys next week, and be careful. And thank you very much. Tim, good to have you back again, man. I'm glad you came back, and I want to thank everybody for shopping, and thanks for stopping. No Black Friday sales, I don't think. Oh, but if you want, seriously, that t-shirt deal is unbelievable. And that's not even through me. So if you want a black t-shirt with anything that you ever wanted to put on it, if you want one of my logos, you can have them. But Sticker Mule has a black t-shirt for $14, and you can't beat it. You cannot beat putting your own design on a t-shirt for $14. I mean, I had a t-shirt company, and I don't know how they're covering themselves. So please make sure that you, if you want something on that, and if you want one of our designs, I will definitely give it to you. Have a happy Thanksgiving. And again, thank you everybody for hanging out, and adios, amigos.